Hello everyone. So today we are highly blessed to welcome our guest today, Ms. Dhanvi Bansal. She has completed her master's in clinical psychology, and by profession, she's a clinical hypnotherapist, past life regression therapist, psychotherapist, numerologist, graphologist, and Reiki healer. And the topic we'll be talking about today is psychological manifestation of body disease. So we welcome you, ma'am, from our side.
Thank you, Karima, for such a lovely introduction. So without any delay, let's start the presentation. As Karima has already told, it's about psychology and disease. So what we're going to learn today is, first there'll be a little conceptualization. You'll understand how your mind and how your body, how your thoughts and how your emotions are linked, and then we'll see how your thoughts and emotions are related to your body cause disease. So before that, I want to take a demo. First, take a deep breath in, empty your lungs completely, breathe out, hold your nose, close your mouth, and now try to think. Hardly for 5 seconds, try to think. This exercise shows that it is extremely difficult to think when you're not able to breathe. What does this say is that your body, your breath, and your mind are very much connected. Now, before explaining a concept, we need to know the history behind how your mind and how your body works. Okay, so from early man to modern man. The early man, was as primitive as the animals right now. They were working completely on the basic instincts. Now, what are the basic instincts? They are sleep, having sex, eating, shelter. These are the basic instincts that cause your survival, right? So what happened was, when they were living like a primitive man, they had no society, they had no structure, no rules were there, and there was no any language or name. And in animal kingdom completely, there are no languages used. This doesn't mean that animals don't communicate, okay? If an animal is angry, they have a different sound. If it's hungry, it produces a different sound. And so was the man at that time. You can see that the brain, the development of brain was only limited to the reptile brain, okay? So the fossil study shows that after every 1 million years, the size of the brain doubled. This means there was an exponential growth in the number of neurons in your brain, right? And the more the neurons you had, the more the information you were able to process. You can see that the minimum creature is a roundworm, and a roundworm has around 320 neurons in his body. Now take the example of a human being who has almost 86 billion neurons in your body. So you can see the amount of information processing that takes place in a roundworm and in a human body, right? So there was an exponential growth in the brain size, resulting in forming of the limbic system, or in the forming of the cerebral cortex, that allowed us to memorize and to process information. Now, and to think also. With the development of the cerebral cortex, there was ability that started, was the ability to think. Now, this doesn't mean that animals can't think. They think, but their thinking is completely based on habitual and instinctual. Okay, this was represented in an experiment by Ivan Pavlov, a Russian psychologist. What he did was, he conditioned a dog to salivate. This conditioning represents, like, if there are two doors in a room, and if the dog is trained to enter the room from a certain door, he will enter only from that door. He won't realize that there is another door and he can use that door. Okay, and humans have the ability to think, right? With this developed the concept of memory, as in, you can see in the work of V.S. Ramachandra, that people or human beings can learn from observation. Okay, you don't have to experience everything in order to learn. For example, from a childhood, our parents are teaching us, don't touch the fire, you'll burn your hand. Don't touch the fire, you'll burn your hand. This doesn't mean to learn to the conditioning between fire and between getting burned. You have to actually experience it, right? This is what happened with us. This is called the mirror neurons. The mirror neurons, basically, observational learning. This happened through visual learning. Okay, you see some people do something, and this is how you observe them. And this is also how the culture preserved it. And the all when the society, when the people got the ability to think, what started happening was a society began. How? People, the most basic instinct was survival, right? They, from animals, they became Homo erectus. From Homo erectus, they became Homo sapiens. And they observed that the animals, there was a constant fight between them and the animals. And animals used to trace them with what? The smell, right? So they found out that if they lived in a group, their chances of survival were more. If they cooked in a certain place and they defecated in a certain place and rested in another place, at night when the animal will come, they will not be able to catch the people. So that's why it gave, living in groups gave a sense of protection. That's why even in today's world, we tend to, go towards a group, because that gives us a sense of protection. We tend to follow our social norms because they gives us a sense of protection that we are a part of group, right? So when you live in a society, you have a certain rules to follow. You have a certain limitations to follow, right? And when you are put into rules, what happens is you try to suppress your need. When you are alone, when the primitive man was completely alone, but when he became a part of a group, there was no concept of mating with your wife or with anyone else if you feel like you did it, right? But when there was a society formed, then there were certain rules. Now what happened was, the more the rules implemented, the more the inhibition of the instincts. And when there was more inhibition of the instincts, there were more emotions repressed. Okay, they kept on repressing their emotions. We can see, like, for example, you saw a tiger, right? You can do only two things, either fight or flight. For example, you chose to fly away, and then there's an intellectual response where you saw there's a tree and you can climb up the tree. You climbed up the tree. The tiger stayed for some time and he say, my prey is up there, and he leaves. What happens next? The crisis is gone and you relax. This is basically controlled by your autonomic nervous system, of course. Then the sympathetic nervous system prepares you for the fight and flight response, and whereas parasympathetic system prepares your body to relax from that certain response. Now, what is happening in today's world is that people are carrying their crisis along with them. How? Like, they go to job, they collect their stress from job, their sympathetic system nervous system gets activated. Now what happens is they bring that stress home, right? And they tend to turn this stress towards maybe their spouse or their children or anyone. Okay, and they go to sleep stressful. Now what happens is, you're not giving your body time to relax or your parasympathetic system to get activated. What happens then is that constantly your body is under stress, under pressure. And when you're not able to express that emotion, what happens is that those hormones, those emotions go and get stuck to your certain body parts. You can understand this by a very common example. If any of you have sinus or have seen people who have developed sinus, sinus is when you develop mucosa on your eyebrows, under your eyes, on your cheeks, and you're not able to breathe after that. The people who have sinus, you will see that they're very indecisive and very confused people. Okay, not very much, that depends on the degree of the sinus they have. They're usually very indecisive and confused. So, as I told you before, that when you're not able to express an emotion, it go and gets collected on a certain part of your body. If you break down emotion, it's emotion, energy in motion. So it's gonna, if you're not going to express it, it repressed. My mentor used to say, an emotion not expressed is repressed. Now you will see that all the chronic and the long-term disease who have this life-altering disease, they form psychosomatic disorders. They have a certain constant pressure, a constant emotion being holding up, right? So there was after World War II, let me explain you this corporational example again. After World War II, if you have heard about Panasonic, within 2 years after the World War II, became as one of the biggest organizations. What happened was that they realized a certain phenomenon, which was further approved in McKinsey's report in 1981. What they found out that every person, every time an incident that leaves employees stressed, it takes 2 days of recovery to come back to peak potential. Let me repeat it again. Every incident that leaves an employee stressed, it takes 2 days to recovery to come back to the peak potential. So what they did was that they, in the basement of their company, they put out cutouts of all their bosses, put a bamboo stick right there. And whenever you get stressed up because of your boss, you can simply go to your basement, take a bamboo stick and thrash the cutout of your boss. This takes 5 to 10 minutes, but you release the stress and you come back to your work working full potential. This is called the bamboo stick approach. Now this helped the person to work, take out the emotion. Now what happened was, like a few months ago, I got this client. He said that from past 2 years, he had this weird stiffness and weird sensation in his jaw. And constantly, he has been to a lot of physicians, a lot of alternative healing techniques. Now, your jaw is typically related to your anger. Whenever a person has issues with jaw or with teeth, he has stored anger in it. And when I asked him about his anger issues, he said that I used to have anger issues, but now I can control my anger. One thing I'm not able to understand is how people can control their emotions. Maybe you don't control them, you repress them. And when you repress them, they get deposited in certain parts of your body. So after 2 to 3 sessions, when we took out all his anger and protected him and told him how to channelize it, he was finally feeling free from the sensations and the stiffness. Like, this is how from the early man, on the basis of survival, you develop this defense mechanisms on depositing your emotions in your body. Another thing that we took from primitive man is the fight and the flight response. Of course, there was a fight between animals and a man all that time. And you could either do one thing, either you could fight or you can flight. Now, humans find when they develop the ability to think, they found out that there are certain situations in which neither they can fight nor they can flight. For example, a big bear come and stand in front of you. What happens is, now you can't flight because he's a huge creature. He runs faster than you. He takes 1, 2, 3 steps and he's on to you. Fighting is not an option, right? Now he found out that there is a third option too. He can do one thing. See, animals don't attack unnecessarily, right? There are only 2 conditions under which an animal would attack. One, if it is hungry. And second, when it feels threatened. See, they developed a mechanism called playing dead. Playing dead is they control your breath and they lie down. You might have heard whenever you see a bear, close your nose and control your breathing and just lie down, play as you are dead. See, if the animal is threatened, then 50% of chances are there that you will survive. If it's hungry, you can't do anything, right? So if it is threatened, it will come up to you, it will sniff, it will see if it's no breathing, it will leave. At least you will have some chances of survival. The modern form of playing dead defense mechanism is depression. You can't fight the situation. And even worse, you can't flight away from the situation. So what you decide is you just come down and sit in a quiet place and don't act at all, right? This means that depression is a chosen response. Now, further moving up to the Hippocrates. Hippocrates is referred to as the father of the modern medicine. He had shown many, 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 many theories And one of them was the personality theory, in which he said that there are four biles present in our body, and that determine the nature of the person. The four biles are black bile, phlegm, yellow bile, red bile, black bile meaning depression, of course, the person who is sad, phlegm, a person who is constantly sick, red bile, a person who is very energetic and sporty, and yellow bile, a person who is very jolly and happy. This is how, of course, this was proven wrong, because there's no certain thing like that. But he was the first person to establish a relationship between your body, mind, and your personality. Now, if you have heard about diathesis stress model, diathesis stress model states that even if you have predisposition of a gene, it won't get activated until and unless there is a certain environment. For example, if someone has predisposition of cancer cells, now it will only get triggered when there is a certain environment it gets provided. You can see in the case of people with epilepsy, when they get epileptic seizure, just before that, you can see in a month or 2 months, they have a period of long exposure of stress. And whenever the stress is good enough that they cannot handle it, they snap and fall into a epileptic seizure attack, right? So then comes up the prenatal period. Now, everyone knows how important the prenatal period is. If you are happy during your prenatal period, then there is a release of oxytocin. Oxytocin is a happy hormone that will make your labor easy. But if you're constantly stressed during your prenatal period, what happens is there is less amount of oxytocin in your body, making your labor even more painful, and this leaves a remark on the children. Now, what happens? Gene modification. After every 7 years, your genes renew, your entire cell body renew. You know the process of cell modification and cell division. Of course, for a new gene to come, earlier one has to die. So what happens is your gene constantly modifies it according to your environment. I will further explain this point in the further presentation. Now, talking about water consciousness, there is this Dr. Masaru Emoto of Japan. He found that there is a change in crystalline structure according to the emotions. And he did an experiment of mice and water. See, human body is made of 70% of water. And he found out that with different emotion, what happens is the crystalline structure of your water in your body changes. What happened during the experiment was that he was observing the crystalline structure of a water, and he received a call. And on the call, he was abusing and he was saying, "You're a fool, you're of no use." And when he came back, he found out that the crystalline structure of water was completely changed. So it made him think that the emotions, the words, changes the crystalline structure of water, how badly it can affect you. A human body that has 70% of water. To further, he did an experiment on rice and water. What he did, he took 3 beakers. They had equal amount of rice and water in it. To beaker number one, he used to say, "I love you" every day. To beaker number two, he used to say, "I hate you" every day. And beaker number three, he completely ignored. What happened after 1 month is that the rice that was said, the beaker number one who was said, "I love you," was flourishing. The beaker number two, who was said, "I hate you," was rotten, was literally smelling. And the beaker number three that had been ignored completely was hard as rock. This shows that your emotion and your words affect water so badly. Now in the further slide, you can see that how beautiful is the crystalline structure of good words like thank you, wisdom, truth, eternal. Every emotion has a different frequency. You can Google, there is an emotional chart, a complete wave, a spiral that shows you that from the minimal emotion to the maximum frequency emotion. You can see here the crystalline structure of words like thank you, angel, I love you, peace, and at the same time the structure of words like fool, you make me sick, evil, polluted water, before and after prayer. Again, for compassion, for thank you, for wisdom, they are so beautiful and so clear and giving you a positive vibe. Whereas heavy metal music and I'll kill you, a fool, I hate you, they have completely disrupted structure of water. Now, the gene modification I told you. So this is how your thoughts and emotions manifest themselves in your body. There's a stimulation from an external environment and your neurons go running to your brain or your thalamus. Let's take an example with stress. There is a stressful stimulation outside the environment. Your neurons go to your hypothalamus going, saying, do, 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 there is something wrong in the environment. Your hypothalamus then communicates with pituitary gland, releasing corticotropin releasing hormone and informing that there is a stressful environment. Now, the pituitary gland releases adrenocorticotropin releasing hormone to adrenal gland. And adrenal gland releases cortisol, that is literally known as the stress hormone. Now, this cortisol travels intercellular or intracellular to the genes, to the target organ, and goes to the gene of that particular organ's cells. Now, in genes, there is encoding and there is the information. Here is where all the, you know, trouble begin. Basically, the gene has this encoded information to how to react and how to survive in certain situations. It will be an information that will come forth. It will give that information to your brain and your brain will tell how your body will react. Now, for example, the cortisol came out and the encoding in your gene was like, raise the heartbeat, raise the blood glucose level, raise the oxygen intake. It is the reaction of your body. Now, when this process is continuously in play, there is deposition of cortisol in your body. Now, what we do is we change the gene modification of certain behavior, right? And your response to it automatically changes. This is what I was talking about mainly, how your thoughts and emotions relate back to your part of the body. How to know what part of body is affected because of what kind of emotion. The first is the crying syndrome. The crying syndrome is your head, your neck, and some of your torso area. When you're not able to express yourself, when you are not able to make decisions, as I told you in sinus, when people are indecisive and confused, this when there is migraine on certain part of your body, there is a fight within, there is a conflict within, then it is manifested in your head, in your neck, and certain part of your torso. Then there is responsibility syndrome. You might have heard the proverb shouldering the responsibility. Whenever a person comes to you with a problem related to your shoulders and your chest, it is basically why, because the person is having a lot of responsibility. Like people with cervical, they have taken up so much responsibility on their shoulders that they cannot handle, right? Then of course arms are used for what? For fighting, right? So whenever there is an issue where you're not able to fight your environment or you're tired of fighting your environment, it gets deposited in your hands and you develop issues related to your hands, right? It can be injuries in your hands. Even there are books that will tell you that what part of your body when gets affected result in what kind of disease. Then there is the guilt and sexual frustration area, that is below your navel and including your abdomen, your genitals, your hips. What happens whenever you're storing a lot of guilt, whenever there is a lot of sexual frustration or sexual insatisfaction, you will see that people develop fat around here. This is basically your emotional factory, right? So you deposit a lot of emotions in your tummy, in your gut, in your abdomen area, and you try to cover it with a layer of fat. Try to protect yourself. There are a lot of people who come to me and that, ma'am, I sometimes gain weight, sometimes I lose weight. There is fluctuation in weight. Why it happens is because there is a lot of sexual frustration in them. Either you can find girls who have that may have gone through some kind of sexual abuse in their past, and 90% of the time they have. Then there is the flight syndrome. Completely your legs. What are your legs used for? To run away, to walk away from situation. Whenever you're not able to run away from a particular situation, your legs start developing some kind of issues, maybe with your knees, with your calf muscles or ankles. You'll see a lot of ladies, they have overweight, they'll be having a lot of fat around their tummy, and their knees will get very much affected. Why is it happening? Is because the environment around them is so much overwhelming that they had to protect themselves, and they are not even they're not able to run away from the situation. this happens then. So this is basically a PET scan of different emotions in your body and how your body reacts to different emotions. You can see in anger, your chest is burning with pride, your arms are ready to fight, your head is boiling with anger. Then there is fear, your heart is palpitating and your entire body is frozen. Disgust, you're not able to speak, you're not able to express yourself, and you're feeling guilty because of it. Happiness, your heart is beating fast, the entire body is running with joy. Now look closely to sadness and depression. Sadness still has some red area telling that your heart is beating and you want can recover, but depression is completely black. You can see that the arms and the legs are completely blue. That means they are frozen. They can't even move, they can't fight, they are completely frozen. For surprise, in neutral state is basically when you are having a non-REM sleep, when you are on stage 1, 2, 3, when your body is experiencing no kind of emotion, and it is completely in guest position. For anxiety and love has different in leg structure, because you love, you don't flight, you don't fight, you're just there. Depression, contentment, pride, shame, and envy, different emotions shows different parts of your body reacting it differently. Now, any questions? Yes, Garima.
Thank you for the session, ma'am. It was a very helpful session. The one thing I want to ask is, like nowadays, when social media is so much popular, everyone is seeing different things and everyone is like, we have to see social media and we have to, like, they are so obsessed with social media right now. And on social media, basically what we see, when there is something talking about any mental health or any mental health issue, they talk be positive, be happy. So see, can you address that thing, like how it is so wrong to tell someone just be happy and be positive every time, because other emotions are also part of their behavior.
Right, exactly. So this is one of the biggest irony. I don't know how people, if you come up tell me be happy and I'll be happy, that doesn't happen. The person who's suffering knows he has to be happy, knows he has to let it go off. The only problem is he's not able to do so now. So you're telling them won't help them. A lot of people come to me bringing their people with depression, for example. Okay, the parents come that my child is suffering from depression. Do you think they will, you know, I will do a magic wand and come out of their depression? Until and unless they are in a bargaining state, they themselves approach me, how can I help them? For example, if you're a doctor, okay, and you give medicines to your client and he's not taking the medicines, can you do anything about it? Nahi na. So what happens is telling people that be positive, be happy, and all your emotions will go away, will not. Tell them that I am here, I see you, I acknowledge you, and I respect your emotions. Okay, and even if you are having on yourself these kind of emotions, tell yourself that, okay, I see you, I acknowledge you, acknowledge your emotions. Don't run away from them. Don't try to escape them. Don't try to inhibit them. Acknowledge them, express them, go to a specialist, of course, and that will help you. And stop comparing yourself on social media. I've seen people compare themselves so badly. And like that girl is 22 years old and she has done so much and I have done nothing. Everyone has a different time. Everyone has a different coping mechanism. Everyone is different. Okay, respect that. Another thing you need to learn is to be alone with your thoughts, with yourself, not with the mobile phone, not with your family, until and unless you learn to be alone with yourself. Now you won't be able to, you know, bend it yourself. Any other question, Garima?
Thank you, ma'am.
Another thing I'd like to address,
you can continue.
Okay. Another thing I'd like to address is that when I conducted this workshop last time, people asked me emotions and COVID. What is happening in this COVID situation? From last 1 year, I have been on this COVID helpline. I receive a lot of calls. And what I have observed is that people who were very much, you know, precautious, they take lot of precautions were the ones who caught COVID very easily. In order to protect your body from COVID, people forget to protect their mind. They were constantly talking about this. They were constantly watching news and everything. And when you think about certain kind of stuff, they are operating out of fear. And fear has a very high frequency. What it does, it is attracting that stuff. Okay, so I can give you an example of a report. It was an experiment done by British Association, Medical Association in 1993 somewhere. And it was published in their magazine. There is a magazine that something named Vidal, I don't remember exactly. So what they did was they took 15 people. Five of them had great knowledge about Mother Teresa. Five of them, they knew Mother Teresa as someone and helped some people. And five people were completely unaware of them. Okay. So they took the blood sample of such people and they tested the immunological titin. That is something that builds your immunity in them. Then they showed a particular movie among Mother Teresa that was very inspirational. Okay, and they tested again their blood sample, and there was significant hike in their immunological titin. I'm sorry, I could not mess up sometimes. That's okay. So there was a spike in their immunological titin. This states proves basically that the state of your mind completely depends. Sorry, your immunity is very much dependent upon your state of mind. Okay.
Yeah, and the next thing I want to ask is like we usually see and learn that we should not suppress our emotions, but is it right to express them every time? Like in some situations, it's not possible. Like if we express our emotion, like if we are angry on someone, if we express it that time, it may harm that person who is in front of us. So how to manage that situation?
See. But when I say we need to express emotions, doesn't mean you have to express it in a certain way. You can channelize that energy. As I said, emotion is energy in motion. It is energy. You have to channelize it. Either, for example, you're angry at someone. There is a hike in emotion. You can express it by, you know, doing boxing or something, going for a run or writing it down. Express that, take out that energy. And then whatever made you feel bad, you can communicate with the other person. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am.
Any other question, Gariba?
That's it, ma'am.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, ma'am.